Well, good morning and welcome. What a beautiful day God's given us to worship together. Those outside, those inside, and all the cameras around here, those who are going to be online later or watching by DVD. Our church is just really, really big. Did you know there are people all the way from Alberta to Nova Scotia who are part of our church? Like, that's a long ways away. Those of you who don't know how far away Alberta or Nova Scotia is, you take pretty much 2 days to get there. Well, maybe not Nova Scotia if you drive real fast. But anyway, not too fast though. Guardian angels only go the speed limit, I'm told. I'm not sure. I don't know, but I just want to encourage you to keep the speed limit down a little bit. We'd like you to come back next week too and join us in worship. Well, we have a great day today to celebrate together. Lots of kids here. There's children's church. We're going to do that a little bit later. We'll let you go out after we sing a song together for the kids. And then after church, there is a special time that you're invited to stay for a light lunch to help celebrate the twins, Melissa and Melanie's birthday. And so they're getting ready out back. Yay! And we're glad to have you here today, and glad that you've chosen to worship with us. Would you stand as we sing this old hymn, Glory to His Name? But it talks about what God can do for us and in us. Let's sing together.
Down at the cross where my Savior died, down where for cleansing from sin I cried, there to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name, glory to His name, glory to His name, there to my heart was the blood. Saved from sin, Jesus so sweetly abides within, there at the cross where He took me in. Glory to His name, glory to His name, glory to His name, there to my heart was the blood. Precious fountain that saves from sin, I am so glad I have entered in. There Jesus saves me and keeps me clean. Glory to His name, glory to His name, glory to His name. There to my heart was the blood. Fountain so rich and sweet, cast your poor soul at the Savior's feet, plunge in today and be made complete. Glory to His name, glory to His name, glory to His name, there to my heart was the blood of.
Yes, Jesus, we give You glory and honor today. You're worthy. You're worthy to receive all of our praise. We praise You for what You have done for us. We praise You for what You have done in us by faith in You. And we ask that today, by the presence and ministry of Your Holy Spirit, You would renew us. Renew our minds, renew our hearts, renew our spirits. Help us to worship You as You ought to be worshiped, so that we in turn can receive all You have for us. We praise You in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. That's okay. If you want to be seated, you can. If you want to stay standing, you may. Here I am to worship. And you know what? I just want to let you folks know, we have some kids in church for the very first time. So let's just give them a little bit of leeway, all right? So the very first time here in church. So let's just let them get used to how we do things, and that'll be all right. So let's sing.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see. Beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. So here it is to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
I don't have the timing right this morning for some reason. You're just going to have to help me with the timing. Just jump in whenever I'm supposed to be starting to sing.
King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake became poor. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. And I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether loved, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
You know, when Jesus shows up, he's the light of the world. He shines in the dark places and he opens our eyes to let us see the beauty that made this heart adore you. We sing that in the first verse. And Jesus can make something beautiful of our lives. There's a chorus the Gaithers wrote that I'd like us to sing at least two times. We might do it three. I don't know yet. It's a beautiful little chorus. Let's sing it together. Something beautiful.
Something beautiful. Something good. All my confusion. All I had to offer him was brokenness and strife, but he made something beautiful of my life. Something beautiful. Something good. All my confusion, he understood. All I had to offer him was brokenness and strife, but he made something beautiful of my life.
Just keep playing for a minute. You know, sometimes there's stuff in our lives that we see, maybe nobody else knows about, that isn't very beautiful. It's kind of ugly, stained, kind of maybe even rotten. Hey? God already knows about it. He sees everything. And He still loves you. He's still for you. And He just says, child, bring it to me. Bring it to me. Lay it at my feet. Let me make something beautiful. Let's sing the chorus again.
Something beautiful. Something good. All my confusion, He understood. Brokenness and strife, but He made something beautiful of my life.
Yeah. God is good, and all the time He is. That's for sure. We don't always feel it. Sometimes we don't always think it, but it's still the truth that He is good all the time. Praise God. Praise God. Just a couple of announcements. Doors Open Loyalist is happening on later this month, on the Saturday, I believe it's June 18. And our church is part of the 20 venues in the township. And so if you want to be part of that day in some way, you can join us here and be part of that. I still need maybe two volunteers who might be willing to, bake cookies or do some things here that would, I just think it would be really neat if we had folks coming into the church and all of a sudden they got a waft of homemade cookies or something baking and then they could maybe take one on their way out. But it's just give an opportunity for folks to learn who we are, about the history of this the building of the congregation here and what God has done for us. Before the kids go down, the kids some of you are still here. I wanted to read this little Bible verse, and then we're going to sing a song based on this Bible verse where Jesus says, "You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hidden." Now, if you think of back in the day, I know it's kind of hard, but back in the day when there was no electricity, you ever had the power go out in your house? You ever had the power go out and it's all black?
Yeah.
You can hardly see a thing. But then if you have lights that aren't electric lights, well, then you can start to see those, right? And back in Jesus' day, they didn't have electricity back then. All they had was like candles or oil lamps. And if a city was up on a hill and all the windows had lamps in them, you could really see that because everything else was pitch black dark. Yes, Micaiah.
What are oil lamps?
Oil lamps. They're kind of like a glass jar with a thread coming out of them. You light the thread and then the flame is on top. Yeah. Okay. So a city on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. That'd be silly, wouldn't it? You light a lamp and then put a bowl on top of it. Then it's not light anymore. It'd be all dark, right? It's like hiding a light. We don't want to hide it. Instead, they put it on its stand, like up in the room, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good deeds, the good things you do, and glorify your Father who is in heaven. So let's sing this song together, the words, "This little light of mine." Do we have those up there, Wayne? "This little light of mine." Oh, it's coming. There we go. So hold your finger up. This is your light, okay? Pretend it's a candle, okay? "This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine." Okay, just a minute. The words up there say, "Hide it under a bushel." What's a bushel? We don't know. So it's kind of like a bowl. Yeah, it's a basket. Okay, so "Hide it under a bushel." No, I'm gonna let
let it shine. Hide it under a bushel. No, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine. Let it shine. Let it shine.
What's the next one?
Don't let Satan it out. I'm gonna let it shine. Don't let Satan it out. I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine. Let it shine. Let it shine. Let it shine till Jesus comes. I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine till Jesus comes. I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine. Let it shine. Let it shine.
What's the last verse? I think there's one more. Is there? Is that it? Okay, good. Excellent. I thought there was one more. Well, let's pray. Father God, thank you that Jesus said he's the light of the world, but then he turned around and said we can be the light of the world. That's only possible if we have Jesus living inside us, in our heart, by the power of his Spirit. So thank you. Thank you that we can be lights too, showing people how good God is. Help us to keep on doing the right thing, to keep on doing the good thing, so that others can see how good you are. We pray in Jesus' name. Bless these children as they go to the children's church. Amen. All right. Are they going this way or? Whatever. Out this door. Okay. Come on. Come on this way, Jordan. There you go. Danny? DJ? All right. Just wait for the adult here. Okay. All right. Good stuff. You have a great time. We'll be seeing you later. All right. You know, we have light through Jesus. He puts his light and his love in us. And it's his love that can really shine through. So let's sing this song together. Why don't you stand? You're going to be sitting for a while when I'm preaching. Why don't we stand together and sing this song and our next one as well?
Lord, I come to you. Let my heart be changed, renewed, flowing from the grace that I found in you. And Lord, I've come to know the weaknesses I see in me will be stripped away by the power of your love. Hold me close, let your love surround. Spirit leads me on in the power of your love. Lord, unveil my eyes. Let me see you face to face. The knowledge of your love as you live in me. Renew my mind as your will unfolds in my life, in living every day by the power of your love. Hold me close, let your love surround me. Bring me near, draw me to your side, and as I wait, I'll rise up like the eagle, and I Your Spirit leads me on in the power of your love. Hold me close. Let your love surround me. Draw me to your side. Your Spirit leads me on in the power of your love.
God's love is an amazing, wonderful thing. And I have one more song. This song has been ringing in my heart almost all week. Just the sense of the wonder of God's love, that He should love me, just to think. Let's sing together.
There's the wonder of sunset at evening, the wonder as sunrise I see, but the wonder of wonders that thrills my soul is the one that God loves me. Oh, the wonder of it all, the wonder of it all, just to think that God loves me. Oh, the wonder of it all, the to think that God loves me. There's the wonder of springtime and harvest, the sky, the stars, the sun, but the wonder of wonders that thrills is the wonder that's only begun. The wonder of it all, the wonder of it all, just to think that God loves me. Oh, the wonder. To think that God loves me.
Father, someone once said the greatest theology they ever knew, and this was someone who had studied the Bible for years and preached many sermons, the greatest theology they ever knew was, Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. It is a wonder. It is a wonder that we who are sinners by birth, aliens and strangers from your love, separated from you, you chose to pour out your love on us. May our hearts continue to respond in ways that bring you honor and glory. And may we be able to now receive whatever you have for us through your word. Help us, Lord. We have ears. Help us to hear. In Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated, please. So, what do Cinderella's, princesses kissing frogs, and an ugly duckling have in common? They're all quacked? Well, maybe not. Not quite. What are they all a story of? They're fairy tales. But what's the main story behind those Cinderella, ugly duckling, princess kissing a frog?
Well, they all become something Different.
Something different.
Transformation.
Transformation. Yes. Now we're getting there. Boy, I tell you, I know it's Sunday morning, and I know you're kind of, you know, this is, you're all chilled and relaxed. Yeah, but I do need you thinking too, so that's good. So, all three really describe a pilgrimage of transformation to beauty, don't they? It's a transformation to beauty. Whether it be a frog becoming a handsome prince, an ugly duckling transforming into a beautiful swan, or an abused young lady becoming the belle of the ball. Beauty is always irresistible. I guess that's why the total global beauty industry spending in 2020 was, get this, this just 2 years ago, the latest stats we have, $483 billion. And the annual total is expected to top $716 billion in another 3 or 4 years. Phenomenal. One little girl was sitting next to her mummy as she put beauty cream all over her face. And this was the first time that the little girl had actually been there when her mummy was doing this. And it looked kind of funny to her, all this white cream all over her face. "What you doing, Mommy?" she asked. "Oh, I'm making myself beautiful, honey." "Oh," was the response, as though she understood, but she really didn't. After the two talked for quite a while, Mommy grabbed a cloth and started wiping off all the cream, and this cute little girl said, "What's the matter, Mommy? Give up." Oh. Oops. Some say that beauty is only skin deep, but I would suggest to you that beauty is an inner quality that can shine through no matter who you are or aren't. The Bible has a Cinderella story for us too. A journey from rags and dirt and stain to an inner beauty that shone through like nothing else. A journey, a transformation from rags to riches. Ezekiel 16, Ezekiel was a prophet who lived somewhere about 600, 700 years before Jesus. And he says this, starting at verse 3, he says this, "Thus says the Lord God to Jerusalem." So this is Ezekiel talking and saying, God wants you people in Jerusalem to hear this, to know this. "Your origin and your birth are from the land of the Canaanite. Your father was an Amorite and your mother a Hittite." In other words, not very noble birth, okay? An Amorite and a Hittite were not considered top class people, okay? Verse 4, "As for your birth, on the day you were born, your navel cord was not cut, nor were you washed with water for cleansing. You were not rubbed with salt or even wrapped in cloths." It gets worse. It gets worse. Verse 5, "No, I looked with pity on you to do any of these things for you, to have compassion on you. Rather, you were thrown out into the open field, for you were abhorred on the day you were born." Just before you go to the next verse, Wayne, I want to say this was not an uncommon practice back in ancient times. If someone got pregnant and didn't want to be, they would have the child and then abandon it somewhere, lay it out somewhere, either for the animals to get or if somebody else wanted a baby, they could come along, pick it up and take it. That was common practice. This was not an unusual thing. Verse 6, "When I passed by you and saw you squirming in your blood, I said to you while you were in your blood, live. Yes, I said to you, or said to you while you were in your blood, live. I made you numerous like plants of the field. Then you grew up, became tall and reached the age for fine ornaments. Your breasts were formed, your hair had grown, you were naked and bare. Then I passed by you and saw you, and behold, you were at the time for love. So I spread my robe over you and covered your nakedness. I also swore an oath to you and entered into a covenant with you so that you became mine, declares the Lord God. Then I bathed you with water, washed off your blood from you, and anointed you with oil. I also clothed you with embroidered cloth and put sandals of porpoise skin on your feet. And I wrapped you with fine linen and covered you with silk. I adorned you with ornaments, put bracelets on your hands and a necklace around your neck. I also put a ring in your nostril, earrings in your ears, and a beautiful crown on your head. Thus, verse 13, you were adorned with gold and silver, and your dress was of fine linen, silk and embroidered cloth. You ate fine flour, honey, and oil. So you were exceedingly beautiful and advanced to royalty. Verse 14, then your fame went forth among the nations on account of your beauty, for it was perfect because of my splendor, which I bestowed on you, declares the Lord God. I'd call that a rags-to-riches story. From something worse than Cinderella to the belle of the ball, God describes in some rather graphic detail what he did for Israel or the people of Jerusalem, in that those folks that live there. How he brought her from nothing, less than nothing, to where they were exceedingly beautiful and rose to be a queen. They even rose to royalty. Some translations you actually use the word queen. Yeah, that truly is kind of the prince and the maiden story. All of a sudden, she is now queen of the land. To where their fame spread among the nations on account of their beauty, for it was perfect because of God's splendor that he had given them. See, God knows the attractive power of beauty. He does. And he made Israel beautiful through his love so that he could show the rest of the world what he could do for the rest of the world if they would acknowledge him and if they would look to him. It should come as no surprise then that God's strategy today to reach a lost world still involves a beautiful bride. The bride image is used in both the Old and New Testaments by God to show us how he wants to attract all people everywhere to himself, to his love and his grace. The name of God's bride in the Old Testament is Israel. The name of God's bride in the New Testament is? The church, right? It's the church. Absolutely. In all three of the synoptic gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, Jesus is recorded as referring to himself as the bridegroom and those who believe in him as the bride. Believers who are waiting for Christ's return are compared to a bride who waits for her future husband to arrive to come and take her away to their newly built home. Let me sort of unpack that for you just a little bit, because every once in a while, especially as Jesus talks to us about bride and bridegroom and so forth, he mentions this. So the custom of Jesus' day was that if a young man and a young woman wanted to get married, he would go and build a home. Sometimes on his parents' property. Sometimes if he had enough money, he would buy a separate piece of property and he'd build a house. And the bride, his bride, they would be officially, formally engaged. It was a very formal thing, the engagement. And it wasn't until the home was finished that they would have the wedding ceremony. Now, it wasn't a specific day as we have nowadays. Right? You have a specific day and you spend all your money and all your time getting ready for that one day. No. The bride would wait at home waiting for her groom to finish the house. And when it was done, when he put the last nail in, hung the last little thing on the wall or did whatever he needed to do, then he would walk with his buddies, usually his friends and some of his family, walk down to her home, which was usually in the same town or village or city, and knock on her door, and she would open. She would be there with her friends, and they would all go to the wedding ceremony. That could last 2 or 3 days, and then they would move into their new home. And so that's the picture that we have that Jesus is trying to help us understand. Because Christians, the church, as the bride of Christ, we are waiting for our groom, Jesus, to come back and take us away to our eternal home. The church is described as Christ's bride, whose beauty is really traced back to God's love for it. God's love cleanses, renews, changes character, creates beauty. You see, it's God's redemptive love is declared in Scripture, demonstrated on the cross, and displayed in the body, the church. That's the way it's supposed to be. You and I, displaying God's love to an ugly duckling world out there, to people who need to know the transforming power of God's love. A beautiful bride. That's one of the main keys to understanding the church. Paul, in describing the relationship between a husband and a wife, puts in there the comparison of the relationship between Christ and His church. In Ephesians chapter 5, starting at verse 25, we read this: "Husbands, love your wives just as Christ also loved the church and gave Himself up for it." You see, he can't even talk about a husband loving his wife without just jumping right over to how Christ loved the church. And then he keeps going with that thought, verse 26, "so that He," Jesus, "might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of the water with the word, that He might present to Himself the church in all her glory, having no spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she would be holy and blameless." Huh. Paul, he's talking about human relationships, but he can't help himself to jump over and talk about the spiritual relationship between Christ and the church, as though Christ is the groom and the church is the bride. And the purpose, number one, of Christ's love is to call out beauty. Did you notice that? Verse 25, "Christ also loved the church and gave Himself up for," verse 27, "that He might present to Himself the church in all her glory, having no spot or wrinkle or any such thing." The purpose is to call out beauty. You can well imagine if on the day of a wedding, the bride came in the back of the church, and the groom stand up here, and she came in with mud smeared over, paint over, dirt on her dress, and all wrinkled up, her beautiful dress all wrinkled up, and he'd be standing, he wouldn't marry her, but he'd be standing going, "What? What happened to you?" You know, and he's expecting a beautiful, radiant bride, no stained wrinkle, all that, all nicely cleaned up. That's the expectation. And that's what Paul tells us is the purpose of Christ's love, to call out this beauty, this radiance. The product, number two, of Christ's love is holiness and blamelessness. Again, back to verses 25 and 27. "Christ also loved the church and gave Himself up for her," verse 27, "that she would be holy and blameless." You see, the product or outcome of Christ's love for His bride is holiness and blamelessness. Now, the word holy describes the church's character. The word holy describes the church's character. The word blameless describes the church's conduct. One describes character, the other describes conduct. In who we are as Christ's bride, the church, we are to be holy. In what we do as Christ's bride, the church, we are to act blamelessly. Now, we're going to come back to those two words in a little bit. Down on your notes section, you'll see that, but we'll come back to that in a minute. I want to talk about the third thing. We've talked about the purpose of Christ's love to call out beauty. The product of Christ's love is holiness and blamelessness. Thirdly, the process by which Christ develops holy character and blameless conduct is His action of self-sacrificing love. Christ also loved the church and gave Himself up for her so that He might sanctify her. That word sanctifies, we don't use that word a whole lot, but it means to set apart as different or holy. All right? That's all it means. To sanctify means to set apart as holy. Jesus Christ gave Himself up for her. And that's quite literally. We sang about that earlier. I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon the cross. Christ literally gave His entire life, laid down His life for the church. As the receivers of Christ's love, we grow and become beautiful. That is holy and blameless. Let's look at those two words for a moment. Holiness and blamelessness. Holiness, one synonym for holiness is wholeness. W-H-O-L-E-ness. Wholeness. God wants you to be whole. And that's what holiness means, really. Nothing missing. No part kind of splintered off. Whole and complete. God's desire and design is to transform us into beautiful people by cleansing us by the washing of the water with the Word. That is the truth. Helping us become people who are whole by the truth. Now, people who are emotionally, intellectually, and most of all, spiritually whole. That is, healed, restored, maturing, so that we are becoming more and more like Christ by His power transforming us. That's the beauty that He wants to see. You know, and He does that through the truth. And so, I don't know about you, I found that sometimes the truth can hurt. You ever found that? Hey? Especially if it's God telling you the truth about who you are or what you've done. It's kind of like going to the doctor. We might not like to hear what she has to say about how unhealthy we are, but she's not saying it to be nasty. She wants us to get healthy. Some of her plan might include painful surgery if we need it, or diet and exercise that we're going to find painful and completely disruptive to our tidied little, you know, ordered life. But the goal is health and wholeness. And God, through His Word, shows us the truth of who we are and what we need. Sinners in need of forgiveness. Broken people in need of regeneration and sanctification. He doesn't do it to be nasty. His goal is holiness. Wholeness, even though some of the process may be painful or completely disruptive to our tidied, well-ordered lives. His goal is developing an inward beauty that will shine out. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Holiness can be described, well, we said, first of all, its synonym is wholeness, right? Second word, blameless. Unblemished from the marring effects of sin. Unblemished from the marring effects of sin. We can live without blame or fault if we are fulfilling the law of love. Because everything else hangs on the two. To love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and your neighbor as yourself. It's kind of neat how it's shaped like the letter L. Love God, love your neighbor. Hey? If we're fulfilling those two, we're living a life without blame or fault. If we filter every action and every word through, is this love for God or my neighbor? Wow. We can live blamelessly. Let me repeat. This is really, really important. If we filter every thought, word, or action through this one thing, is this love for God with all my heart, soul, mind, strength, or is this love for my neighbor as myself? We can live blamelessly. Wow. Does that mean that we still won't have, does it mean that we won't have nasty people around us telling us we were wrong or doing whatever? No, it doesn't. As a matter of fact, in 1 Peter chapter 2, we're told that. But listen to this, 1 Peter 2, verse 11 and 12. Dear friends, I urge you, as foreigners and exiles, to abstain from sinful desires which wage war against your soul. Verse 12, here it is. Live such good lives among the pagans, the unbelievers, that though they accuse you or blame you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day He visits us. So it's not that you will be able to go through life without some kind of accusation or blame, but on the day when God shows up and the judgment seat is there, people will go, oh, I blamed you for that. I said you did wrong there, but I realize now, it wasn't in light of who God is and who God was in your life. God, you were in them. You see, we can't necessarily live all of our life without somebody telling us we did something really, really wrong, when in our motive and our heart and our intent was only love for God or love for our neighbor. But all of that will be corrected in the end. So don't worry. Don't worry about all that stuff. You keep your heart clean and right with God. The blameless life will always shine through. And holiness is the foundation of blamelessness. You cannot be blameless if you're in your conduct, if you are unholy in your character. Here's the point. Holy character expresses itself through blameless conduct. Holy character expresses itself through blameless conduct. Joe Aldridge, in his book Lifestyle Evangelism, says that when a person, a family, or a corporate body of believers are moving together toward holiness, a credible lifestyle emerges, blamelessness. That is when their potential to attract others to Christ, their beauty, increases dramatically. All of this, the process of beautification, the holiness, the blamelessness, the attractiveness of our lives, the light shining out of our lives begins and ends with God. It must or it will fail. It is only God's love that makes the beautiful transformation possible. Ezekiel 16 is a really graphic illustration of this. Israel went from an abandoned baby, as it were, still in the blood of birth, out in the field somewhere, left for the animals or left for whoever wanted to come along. They went from that to royalty. What an amazing transformation. It's the good news journey offered to every man, woman, and child. It's the gospel in a nutshell. God is in the business of transforming rubbish heap rejects into royalty through the power of His love. Have you experienced this transforming power in your life? Have you asked God to wash you clean of all the stain of your sin? To clean out all the garbage of your past and give you a new and fresh start with Christ? God is ready, willing, and able to do it if you will humbly and honestly ask Him. God believes in you, and He wants to make something beautiful of your life. He understands the confusion. He understands the pain. He understands all of that. Just bring it to Him. Just bring it to Him. I've often said that God is the greatest garbage man in the world. He's the only one who can reach into the moral toxic waste dump of our soul and deal with it and clean it out. God believes in you. And He'll do it with this purpose in mind, to put you on display to your family, your friends, your neighbors, your coworkers. I've seen this happen over and over and over again, especially with guys who came out of prison. I like to tell people I was 12 years old the first time I went to prison. But my parents had prison Bible study ministry for 16 years every Wednesday night. And I've seen guys who were the world's rejects absolutely transformed by the power of God's love. Absolutely transformed. The one guy, Nick, I think I've told you about him before. He was a big guy. I mean, he was probably about 6'4", 6'5", just built like a brick house. Anger just all through him. And my mom, at about 5'5", one day just lit into him. Nobody ever talked to Nick that way. If they did, they'd have a broken face at the end of it. I mean, he used his fists, and he's been accused of, in a fight, killing somebody, and it was proven to be self-defense. So he had the reputation of killing somebody with his hands. Mom lit into him, just lit into him. And he stormed out of the chapel, red-faced, veins bulging in his neck. I mean, this is a big guy. And about four other inmates surrounded Mom. Mom, you don't know what you've just done. He's going to be waiting outside the chapel for you. But he has to come through us first. They were willing to put their own lives on the line for Mom. She said, "My God's bigger than that, than Nick. You guys go sit down. Let's start." So they started their prayer time. And Mom looked over to the corner of the chapel, and there was Nick sitting in the dark corner of the chapel. And Mom started to get up. Two guys grabbed Mom either side. "Where are you going?" "I'm going to talk to Nick." "Let go. It'll be all right." She walked over, sat down beside him, put her hand on his back, and she realized his body was shaking. He was crying. He had been crying, and Mom looked down. Between his knees on the floor was a puddle of tears. And after he stopped enough to be able to look up at Mom, his face just wet with tears, Mom said, "Nick, what's going on? Nobody has ever loved me like that," referring to the chewing out that Mom gave Nick. He got it. And it transformed him from a man who was full of anger and hate and bitterness to a guy who was, I don't know if he developed the nickname or us kids called him a gentle giant. He was the most gentle, humble guy you'd ever want to meet after that. God transformed him. And God can transform anybody. Anybody. Where was I? I'm in my notes here somewhere. Now I'm not even sure where I am. I love it. God believes in you. Yes. God can change and transform anybody. That's what he did with Israel. And what did the world see when Israel's beauty was on display? Well, the splendor of God himself. His great name. His mighty power. And Jesus came to show us how beautiful God really is and how beautiful we can become. He told his disciples, anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. He was, as it were, a visual aid to reveal the beautiful nature of his Father, our Father. He didn't just talk about love. Jesus loved and sinners considered him their friend. He didn't just preach on forgiveness. He forgave right up to the very end. He didn't start a Bible Institute or establish a chair of theology in his Father's name. He invited others to live with him 24/7. His strategy was to live a flesh and blood existence with us, to be a living example of God's beauty, his holiness, and his blamelessness. You see, and when God starts the transformation, it doesn't always happen like that. Sometimes it can take days, weeks, months, even years for that transformation to take place. But God can do it. He can do it. The pre-Christian, the person who has not yet come to personal faith in Jesus Christ, needs a visual aid which shows that the gospel really is good news, that it really does meet the deepest need of the human heart. And that's where God is calling on you and I. God wants to create in you and in me the attractive power of his beauty, his holiness, his blamelessness. Author and speaker Sheldon Vanauken once wrote this: "The best argument for Christianity is Christians. Their joy, their certainty, their wholeness. But the strongest argument against Christianity is also Christians when they are somber and joyless, when they are self-righteous and smug in their complacent consecration, when they are narrow and repressive, then Christianity dies 1,000 deaths." Too often in the past, Christians have let the beauty make them think that they are special, as in more special than anybody else, above everybody else, and pride sets in. We have a warning toward this back in our original passage from Ezekiel 16. Let's go back to that passage and start again at that last verse 14, where Ezekiel says about God, to Jerusalem, to the people living there, "Your fame spread among the nations on account of your beauty, because the splendor I, God, had given you made your beauty perfect," declares the Sovereign Lord. Verse 15, "But you trusted in your beauty and used your fame to become a prostitute. You lavished your favors on anyone who passed by, and your beauty became his. You took some of your garments to make gaudy high places where you carried on your prostitution. You went to him, and he possessed your beauty." Verse 20. "And you took your sons and daughters whom you bore to me and sacrificed them as food to the idols. Was your prostitution not enough? You slaughtered my children and sacrificed them to the idols. In all your detestable practices and your prostitution, you did not remember the days of your youth when you were naked and bare, kicking about in your blood." You see, they had become so full of themselves that they forgot their humble origins. And our God is a jealous God. The Bible tells us that. As any righteous husband would be jealous if another man was paying way too much attention to his bride, so our Heavenly Father. In other words, be careful about giving other gods any attention. The gods of money, sex, alcohol, self, the list could go on and on and on. One more thought about a beautiful bride as the displayer of God's love and splendor. God's bride is not a person, but a people in relationship. God's bride is not a person, but people in relationship. The beauty that God desires others to see appears as we relate to one another like He intended it for us to. If we are fighting amongst ourselves or constantly finding fault with each other, the radiance of the beauty grows dim. And I don't just mean the folks here in Wilton Church. I mean, if there's folks attending another church and we're critical, we're nasty, we're kind of picking on them, that doesn't help anybody, does it? Soon, Augustus. Yeah, soon, okay? Yeah, soon. You go back out there, okay, bud? Okay, you close the door. Nana will be out soon. All right. You know what? I would rather have kids here doing that than no kids here at all. Amen? Okay, so let's just keep going. All right. The beauty that God desires to others to see appears as we relate to one another like He intended for us to. And this is what our Lord meant when He said, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you meet on Sundays at 11 and Tuesdays at 7 p.m. Is that what He said? Nope. He didn't either. Everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. That's it. There's the beauty. Christ's beautiful bride is the church, people in relationship to one another. You know what? You can pick your friends, but you're stuck with your family. Right? And I don't know about you, but in our family, we've got some ones that, yeah, I kind of feel stuck with. And you know what? Your church family? You're stuck with your family. And you don't always get along. You don't always see eye to eye. But you know what? We can always treat each other with respect and love. Always. Amen. Always. Amen. Christ's beautiful bride is the church. People in relationship to one another. God has designed your relationships with other Christians as the primary context in which His nature, His beauty shows up here on earth. Something that others will see and then know who God is. Oh, that's who God is. You see, not many, if any, pre-Christians are reading the Bible and finding out who God is. Many are reading about who God is and as He is revealed in your life and in your relationships. Like it or not, Scripture calls us living letters read by everyone. We are literally Bible translators for lost people. Earlier we sang, this little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Let it shine till Jesus comes. How are you doing? Is your light shining brightly? Or maybe, as I tried to describe to Micaiah, the oil lamp. We still use oil lamps, especially if the hydro goes out, like using oil lamps. But you know, if you turn the wick up too high, what happens? The wick starts to smoke and the glass gets all black and smudgy and then it's not very... So you know what? If I get too proud, pride can sometimes cause that light to get blocked out a little bit. How are we doing? Is your light really, really, really small? You're just barely shining? Or is kind of stuff not working very well for you? Tell God. Let Him know. Let Him know. And ask Him to help you. He will. He absolutely will. Father God, we thank You and praise You for who You are. Jesus, You are the light of the world, and You said we are also the light of the world as we place our faith in You. Help us to do that, to continue to trust in You, to believe in You as You believe in us, that holiness and blamelessness can become the kind of character and conduct is displayed in our lives as we worship and honor You. Amen. Just before we sing our closing song, some of you are wondering what the bells are about. Back 2 years ago, when COVID first started, there was somebody who wanted to ring the church bells in Napanee in honor of the healthcare workers. And they started that here in Wilton and have done it every Sunday at noon ever since. And they were going to stop once the whole COVID thing is over. So that's why the bells are ringing right now. So just wanted to let you know that. And pray for the healthcare workers too. But let's sing a song here. Would you stand with me as we sing this song? I hope you know it. And if you don't, you'll catch on to it soon. I need you guys to help me sing this because I'm not terribly familiar with it, but I do like the song.
Let the beauty of Jesus be seen in me. All His wonderful passion and purity. May His Spirit divine all my being refine. Let the beauty of Jesus be seen in me. When my burden is heavy and hard to bear, when my neighbors refuse all my load to share, when I'm feeling so blue, don't know just what to do, let the beauty of Jesus be seen in me. When somebody has been so unkind to me, some word spoken that pierces me through, spat upon and reviled, let the beauty of Jesus be seen in me. From the dawn of the morning to close of day, in example, in deeds, and in all lay my gifts at His feet, ever strive to keep sweet, let the beauty of Jesus be seen in me.
Let the beauty of Jesus be seen in you. That's His love. So love God, love each other, and go out there and be the church. And if you want to stay and sing one more song, I love this song. Let's play that, Take My Life. You can go, or you can stay and help us sing this song. But this song talks about holiness, faithfulness, and righteousness.
Holiness, holiness is what I long for. Holiness is what I need. Holiness, holiness is what you want from me. So take my heart and form it. Take my mind, transform. Take my will, conform it to yours, O Lord. Faithfulness, faithfulness is what I long for. Faithfulness is what I need. Faithfulness, faithfulness is what you want from me. So take my heart and form it. Take my mind, transform it. Take my will, conform it to yours, O Lord. Righteousness, righteousness is what I long for. Righteousness is what I need. Righteousness, righteousness is what you want from me. So take my heart and form it. Transform it. Take my will, conform it to yours.
If you'd like to stay, come on back to the hall and stay for a bit of a light lunch. Otherwise, God bless you as you go. Amen.